And we're going to start with Anne on open space because she doesn't need the technology.
Hi. We had two meetings. One was with a bigger group and the second one was a small group today. So basically you've all got our report in your hands. So I'm not going to take a lot of time going over it. I'll briefly run through what is in this. I apologize for not having pretty slides. As the open space person, I should have pretty slides. We gave those to you months ago and I wasn't able to pull them back up. Anyway, we met before we saw the, before the February 4th update of the neighborhood plan, so there's some comments in here that are, that follow on the neighborhood plan. Our feeling, my feeling looking at it after the neighborhood plan is that it's beginning to move in the right direction. They're clearly making an effort to find more open space. That's the focus of this discussion is how do we get the enough and the right kinds of open space in Union Square. So we reiterated a commitment to the goals that we set out at the CAC for 34% of the land area going into open space. The plan, the current neighborhood plan does not hit that target yet. It's moving in that direction, but we continue to feel that that's important, not as a matter of abstract percentages, and but partly as a matter of meeting the summer vision goals of hitting 125 acres of new open space for the city, and partly because we think it'll make a better Union Square and Boynton Yards, that very little of the city has any real open space at the neighborhood level. What we do have is extremely well used and very appreciated, and as would be more. And so we really feel that it's better for the quality of the place, both ecologically in terms of stormwater management and Heat Island and all those environmental effects, in terms of public health, and in terms of the quality of life for the community. So we're committed to keeping that percentage of approximately 20 acres of open space. We feel there's a need to develop a more specific sort of portfolio of what those kinds of open spaces we want. We talked about lush, quiet spaces, the ambition that some of the spaces be really pretty intensely green, while some other spaces might be more plazas and cafe stuff. That there be some wilder spaces that are doing ecological work, plazas, water spaces, playgrounds, playing fields, paths, connecting paths, dog parks, maybe urban farm and community gardens. So those were the categories of spaces that we outlined, and we can do some more work on exactly what that means. When Philip and Shu and I and others worked on this earlier, we had sizes for each of those kinds of things. So we can go back and plug that information in. And looking at statistics of what is kind of normative for the population, you get numbers of between 6 and 10 acres per 1,000 residents, and at 70,000 residents, that's, whether you're at 70,000 residents and 8 acres, you get about 540 acres is what the city should have, or if you talk about 90,000 residents with all the new, with the 6,000 new units, you are at least 540 acres at 6 acres per 1,000. So we have about 120 acres and we're trying to double that and add another 125 acres. We're still way, way, way under what is considered normative. So we don't want to let up at all on asking for these requirements. We think that the issue is that it's not that every single parcel is going to be able to provide 30-35% open space. Some of that space would not be meaningful or useful, but the idea is you build it or buy it. You develop it or contribute to it. So at the time of getting permits, there has to be a strategy in place for either contributing to a larger open space somewhere in the square area or in the city or taking care of it on your own parcel. We felt that George seemed to be saying in the last presentation that they had heard us on counting expanded sidewalks and traffic islands as not in the high-quality open space category that we're looking for, so that was a plus. Also, we think that green roofs and various other mitigation strategies are really desirable, but don't also count on a one-to-one basis of the, towards the acreage we're looking for. Another issue was that the city is desperately in need of serious recreational space. The high school is down a field because they lost one at Lincoln. They don't have enough practice fields. They're looking for 3 to 4 significantly sized fields in the near future. And if the city doesn't see the opportunity to provide those fields on the transformative district of Boynton Yards, the current plan that was commissioned for Inner Belt also doesn't show serious playing field space. So, you know, it doesn't have to be in Union or Boynton, but we really want to know where it's going to be before we give up that land in Boynton Yards particularly. So Russ's plan for the parks on the two sides of the tracks offers a serious possibility for real space. If we could deck the tracks, we're sure the Green Line would love to pay for that. So we want to work with the city to establish the citywide plan for meeting those needs, not to be just obstructionist on this one set of development standards in the neighborhood plan. Equally, there's been a lot of work done on stormwater management, but a lot of that has to do with repairing infrastructure under the street. We'd like to get that integrated with a plan for maximizing the surface management of stormwater. Where is it flowing from? How do we handle it on the streets? Where do we green the streets to filter it and reabsorb it? And where do we need, how do we use open spaces as part of a stormwater management system? So there are all these different planning efforts, our feeling is, but they're not integrated. The city's open space and recreation plan is not integrated with the transformational district planning. The stormwater management infrastructure is not integrated with the street design plan. So all of this could be done. It's not that hard, it's just a matter of pulling it together. We talked about acquisition strategies. The CPA is a possible revolving fund, land trusts, transfers, things like that. And then roles and responsibilities, I think, gets to the crux of the question tonight, which is how would we use a, you know, potentially how would we use a place management organization. We feel that it's really important to work with the city to clarify who's responsible for what and who's in charge of what. What might go to a PMO, what is owner's responsibility, city responsibility. It was suggested that the city should have a parks and rec department. Maybe somebody likes watching Amy Poehler. But I gather we don't have the city organized that way, and so the question of fields and management came up, and what is the best organization for that? And the job of that might be management and maintenance of open space, assuring public access, stormwater management standards, programming, citizen participation. All of this might, many of these things might fall into the PMO, as well as providing, being a kind of watchdog on design quality, providing expertise perhaps on design mitigation for air pollution issues near the major roads, overseeing management and programming, and being a kind of a manager for the funds, that a channel for funds that might be collected either from a transfer tax. The other were a bunch of strategies for how to engage the community and some different ideas about the high school and undergraduate research program opportunities at Tufts and BU. So are there questions and comments, I hope, because that was my talking time. Now there's time for you guys. Yeah.
I have two quick comments. Thank you, that's awesome. It's really great. So the one is I'd push for us to say what a green space versus open space balance goals are. So, and I know that it's gonna take time to set those so that we don't get just closets.
Right, there's a comment in there.
And I saw that comment, so that'd be great. So if we can figure out what that percentage is, I don't know. And then the second one is, I would I'd say pushing for developers to do rooftop gardens that are publicly accessible would be wonderful too, to get that other, I mean, it's very, you know, serene to be that high up and away from the traffic noise in a green space.
Great. I gotta get my pen so I can write these things down. Other comments? Any comments about the relationship of responsibilities that we're trying to start outlining here, or what we're hoping the city does versus developers? I just get an A and go home?
Is there any space allocated for art, for culture?
That's a really good point, and it is not... we did not talk about that in this, but I think we can definitely add that as a component of public space.
It's very important.
Yeah. I think there are a lot of issues around the design of the public space, which might be open space, might be street space, might be a lot of things, and that would be definitely should be part of the guidelines. Thank you.
So I believe that Mike is up next if the computer.
One more, two more comments. Yeah.
Oh, I was just going to suggest other solutions for managing the space could be neither developer or city. It could be something like, and Chris, forgive me for saying this out loud in a public meeting, could be some sort of expansion of Groundwork Somerville, or maybe the Growing Center would want to take responsibility for something. So there could be some other creative solution given our existing partners in the area who could play a role.
Okay.
Sorry, Chris.
Can you
add on? Yeah, I think as well as we build, I like the concept of breaking ground for a park and whatever parcel gets developed at the same time. Like having the park in before development starts. So before, you know, the hard stuff goes down, establishing where the parks are. So I think that would be important, just to integrate it before, you know, just starting to build.
Yeah, I mean, even seeing people go ahead and do the tree planting before anything else gets done, so that you, by the time you're really developing the area, the trees have grown up and it has real sense of place. Yeah.
This is an open space. I just want to put this on our to-do. I have to leave at 7:20, and I'm sorry, but we started the conversation about the sustainability, climate change, environmental things, and having a separate working group for that. So I just don't want that to get lost tonight. Not on the agenda anywhere, and I've already said I'd be happy to lead that up if we decide that's the way we want to go, but I have to leave early so you can assign it.
Yeah, thank you. I meant to add that to this, that this is not addressing that, and we recognize that, and there are a lot of really interesting issues in there, both at the scale of, you know, by development and building, but also at the district scale in terms of district energy and all those kinds of things. I think it's a really important piece. Yeah.
Well, so on that, you know, I think there was some hope that each of the working groups could address sustainability, climate, energy, and also finance, including non-local finance sources. But that may just be too far for these working groups to do. So it may be in both cases, we may need to have a separate group, and maybe a group that integrates and works with the city's departments, the city's parallel departments. Certainly, the more funding we get from outside, the more community benefits are left inside, and the sustainability kind of goes across the deck. So,
Joe,
we also did sort of talk in tangent a little bit on architecture design, that there should be some incentives for architecture design. We haven't talked about that at all yet, and I don't mean to throw that on this committee, but I do mean to put that on this committee. That we should eventually be talking about what kind of incentives can we develop, what kind of architecture can we produce, because we want to do stuff.
I think that the issue to me is really, and it goes to both the open space, but it's the public space, the public realm, and what are the design guidelines that guide the development of that. Rather than seeing it as an architectural problem, it's how do we get the public realm that we want, both in terms of streetscapes and in terms of open spaces and all those. And I think that the neighborhood plan needs to move towards being a design guideline rather than a very specific plan.
The only way that I see a corollary is the way that the MBTA just said today, I think it was, that they were not going to be paying for art work in the subway stations where they have in the past. And that becomes a real problem that there was a 1%, they spent 1%, yeah, 1% I think it was, when they built Porter Square, and 1% here would represent, $100 million. This is a lot of money.
Other comments for, okay, who's next?
Well, I think if Mike wants to go.
Well, no. Just go on some kind of a question, and I'll come up before that.
Okay, all right.
So, good evening. So, we have the agenda. We just went first with Ann because she was ready and she also set a very high bar. So, economic development.
Hi, Stephen Mackey. Economic Development Working Group, there's 15 of us that communicated by email, 9 met on Saturday. The goal of the group is to create a comprehensive approach to new jobs and employment opportunities that involve all 3 levels of employment, export, regional, and local. The neighborhood concept is to develop the Union Square Boynton neighborhood into a significant employment center able to support and sustain diverse businesses at all stages of growth. Provide residents and local businesses with opportunities to work and grow, and create new commercial taxes that expand city services. Initially focus on drawing off demand for small to medium-sized office and lab tenants located in other parts of the metropolitan core, Kendall Square, with the idea that once the neighborhood gets traction as an employment center, large anchor companies can be attracted. The economic potential of Union Square Boynton Yards is found in its unique community character and its urban core address, a genuine cultural neighborhood amid regional global players and amenities. We should aim to create an ecology of firms of different sizes, stages of development, and complementary services. I would call on other members of the group to help deliver the rest of the report. The next one is Bill Shelton.
I just want to say I love my working group. I learned a lot. I mean, it was enjoyable working together, and I learned a lot. So, preliminary action items. What I'm going to report on is the action item, attract employees. So we would begin by examining the strengths and weaknesses of Union Square as an employee destination, recognizing that with many of the companies that we want to attract, the thing that most figures into the location decision is where their employees want to be. Research precedents for other employment districts, kind of best practices analysis. Greg and Paul and I were talking about a while ago, and one of these two characters mentioned the notion of maybe having a recruitment team. And this came up in our meeting, and we talked about an evangelist for Union Square and mentioned a very successful young woman in the Seaport District who played that role. So number 3 is establish a neighborhood director of economic development to promote and serve as the nexus between community, city, and developers in formulating and implementing a neighborhood economic development approach. Develop a tax incentive program to attract initial upper story companies to Union Square to create initial critical mass. The idea is that for fairly short money on giving up taxes in the short run, we can get a whole lot, you know, if we calculate it in terms of net present value. Leverage proximity to Kendall Square and Boston employment centers. It's becoming increasingly clear that the Union Square could, and Boynton Yards could very well be a safety valve for what is the world's most intense innovation district, located 0.6 miles from Boynton Yards. Invest in infrastructure aimed at attracting businesses, for example, fiber, shuttle to and from Kendall, et cetera, and as I mentioned earlier, establish a recruitment team.
And next is to do workforce development at Van Hardy.
The first part of the meeting was primarily how to attract employers, and then we asked the question, how do we connect that to the local population? And so what we talked about was like developing programs in the high schools, the local colleges, the community college, and we also talked about, you know, developing programs with the businesses. Some of the things that we still have to talk about is like who's going to pay for these, you know, the trainings. We don't want the employees to have to pay for it. We want, you know, to be able to, for the community or for, you know, the employers to chip in on that. So the other thing that we talked about was we do have existing programs. The First Source program is a good example. We talked about taking an inventory and looking at, like, you know, what we have in the community currently and then building on that. I think, you know, the other thing that we didn't really get a chance to talk about that we should have was connecting this to displacement and making sure that people in the community that are at risk of getting displaced have, like, an opportunity to get a good job that they can live on. So that was basically it.
And to talk about local independent businesses, Esther Hayden.
I think the mic's off.
Is it on?
No.
No.
I think it was.
Now is it on?
Yeah, it's good.
So we talked about local independent businesses, and part of what we talked about is, you know, part of the attraction of Union Square are our existing businesses and what a unique area we are. So one thing we talked about was perform a threat assessment for local business to understand the greatest risks and help find strategies to address them. Pursue policies and programs to support local business, such as a fabrication district, tax incentives for benevolent landlords, tax discounts for specific new space and development targeted at local independent businesses. We talked about, you know, we certainly talked a lot about, which is, you know, kind of related to this, is making sure that we take advantage of our fabrication and innovation district and, you know, and help to strengthen that through the new development. We talked about expanding and strengthening technical assistance to interested and engaged current local businesses, to help them take advantage of the changing market to strengthen their financial viability. That would help them to meet the increasing costs that we think are going to come from this development, but also to take advantage of the opportunities. And exploring a limited number of spaces with affordable rents for a predictable period. This is for some of the businesses that, you know, might be displaced because the rents go up so quickly. So we want businesses that really, you know, have the ability, given the resources, to be able to expand their economic vitality. And, you know, we talked about a process to do that, that we would choose the businesses based on a rigorous and comprehensive review of what factors are involved in their displacement, a market analysis of their customer base, a strong business plan, and a proven record of business acumen, commitment, and follow through.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
Yeah, so thank you guys. That was a great report back, and I'm sorry I couldn't come to any of the meeting times. I had a question, something about Bill that you had raised, and I think it came up a couple times actually, which was the idea of tax incentives for companies to come to Union Square, which seems a little confusing to me because I think you also mentioned like Union Square as kind of relieving the pressure from Kendall Square, and I know you've been actually a pretty vocal and articulate advocate for more commercial development that can increase our local tax base. So it seems counterintuitive that we would then give tax breaks to companies that are coming into Union Square. That doesn't really make sense to me.
I'll answer this. I want to answer it briefly because, as we anticipated, it would evoke reactions like yours. And it really comes down to what I said before, and that is a net present value calculation. How much do we, what we were talking about is perhaps a 50% break in the first year, 40% the second, 30% going down. And when you net that out to like 10 year, let's say 10 or even 20 years, it's minuscule. So we gave the example of Vertex, which is in Joe Fallon's development on Fan Pier, where the city gave a fairly small, what some would think was, gee, that's a sweet tax break. The next, within a year, Fallon had sold the property, and the property is now worth more than all of Somerville's commercial tax base put together. And it's generating a great deal of income for the city of Boston.
Are those tax rates effective in drawing people in if they're such a small amount over the long term, though?
Yeah.
That
is an excellent question, and I think that's worthy of consideration before we agree to or how to do a tax incentive program.
I feel like people are going to put their business in Union Square for the long term. Unless they're a very small, but if we're talking about like large,
Let me give you a very brief answer, anyone else who wants to? Well, I've been talking to some developers, some commercial developers lately, trying to interest them in Union Square and assess their interest. And one of the large biotech developers in particular. And one of the things that I'm hearing is everybody knows that that something has to be done in Kendall Square. Demand exceeds supply 4-1. This guy says we're eating ourselves, and if we don't solve this problem, we're going to be in trouble. But no one knows yet exactly where the right safety valve is. Some people are going to the Seaport. Some people are going to 128. So it's hard to tell. What is embedded in what I read is the idea that this would be an initial program to develop momentum. So I think there are a lot of
jump. It's worth it in a short term, and then.
I think your question is an important one to answer. A second one is, how long does this go on for?
There's one other thing, if I could, which is that some of these businesses have a very high discount rate when they're looking forward. So the amount of money that
you should explain for all of us.
Well, they count their current money much more highly than 3 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now. A community and a city are thinking long-term with regard to their money. So that gap in thinking is what makes like a short tax break for Vertex look really attractive to Vertex and look like not much to give away to the city of Boston or to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
Good point.
In the description, it says tax incentive program to attract initial upper-story companies to Union Square to create initial critical mass. So,
and one tiny other thing, I think it was covered in the presentation, but one reason to do this is to simultaneously look for more affordable space for the existing small businesses or the garage startups as an offset to that break.
I think I have questions about this as well, and I'm going to try to make sense of it on my own a little bit. One thing I'm thinking about is, you mentioned also potentially having a shuttle that goes to Kendall Square or something along those lines. Is that something that you imagine would be funded by the businesses or by the city or the T? Or, yeah, did you talk about that yet?
No.
Greg, do you have any?
Yeah, I think it it's probably more of a district-wide solution. So, you know, the idea would be to try and improve connectivity between Union Square and Kendall Square so that we can create more synergy between the largest, you know, employment center that's proximate to Union Square. And so whether that would be, you know, passed on in some way to the employees and having the employees pay for that service, or it would have to be worked out. It's probably a combination of sources, I would think, and depends on the scale. I think the other thing would be to look, you know, to talk to the MBTA about how to improve bus service between the two locations as another, you know, important part of that.
Yeah, I think that's just it. I hear many incentives for businesses to come, and that being, you know, one of the incentives as well as potentially tax breaks. So when we look at all of the benefits we're giving the businesses to come here, I think just looking at that carefully and making sure what we're giving is equal to or less than what we're getting in some sense.
The mobility group talked about this a lot, about how to get people around. And there's, well, the way most regions do it is they have a transportation management association that manages that. It's a separate entity that does that for whatever region it is.
The 85 and the 90, the 85 and the CT2 buses already connect Union Square and Kendall. And I'm thinking that after a certain critical mass, what it could turn into is just a much more frequent schedule. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is there another question?
This may be addressed through zoning. I just want to make sure that we limit storm-based retail and also encourage businesses or require businesses to pay a living wage of at least $15 an hour. So I don't want this to be Assembly Row with all these, you know, ground floor retail. I think we could be more creative than that, and sort of change the character, require businesses that have a certain standard, livable wages, and maybe even employee benefits.
Anybody else?
Actually, a second question, sorry. For Esther, actually, regarding, you mentioned the threat analysis for businesses and helping businesses that are at risk of displacement. Did you talk at all about how to support businesses that are currently on the D parcels if they want to stay in Union Square, giving them an option to stay and finding creative solutions to help them through that process?
No.
We didn't get into that detail. And one of the things that we did start to explore was the idea that displacement, we really have to get into the definition of displacement. Because we suspect there are various causes of displacement, and one of which very definitely is development, but there are other causes as well. And one of the things that we have to be able to do is figure out how we're going to distinguish what's causing the displacement to begin with. So that's part of the ongoing discussion.
You don't get it. Let me say it a different way. When I was a wee tyke, I founded and managed an organization that consulted the small businesses and either helped them expand or persuaded them that if they didn't want to get a divorce or go bankrupt or lose the house that they had pledged security on, they ought to close it down. And the point of this is some businesses, whatever happens, are not going to survive. And as a funder of mine once told me, we don't fund funerals. So if we're taking, you know, if we're investing public funds or very precious limited funds, we have to be very careful. And sometimes helping people prolong the agony is not kindness.
I think we can follow up on that maybe, because I have a lot of thoughts that would take away from our meeting.
I would love a conversation with you, Chris.
So the question was specifically about the D parcels, though, and I mean, there's requirements under, I'm blanking on the federal legislation, but you got to take care of those people and help them relocate.
That's right.
If they're displaced.
I was just going to make the same point. I mean, on the D blocks, we have an obligation to work with those parcels. Mm-hmm.
So both of these presentations were really in-depth, and I'm going to ask Steve if you and your team could get what you were reading from to Kira.
Yeah.
So, because our job is to organize it in a common format. The other thing, and Ann and I talked about this beforehand, we need to have a sense of prioritization of the items that you're talking about. Now, sometimes you can't because they just are sort of basics. But, you know, going back to your comments, Anne, you know, of the various open space types, which are the most important, or at least, that's probably not the right way to put it, but from a timing point of view, which needs to come first, second, and third? Because we need to give direction to this whole strategy so that we know what's going to happen next. Because you can't, I mean, these are phenomenal ideas, and you can't push them all at the same time. You drive yourself crazy. So we need a sense of prioritization from a timing point of view. What logically comes first and what logically comes second. So if you can get that to Kira, and that is because Victoria's not here because she had a bouncing baby boy. She had a very, she had a miserable pregnancy, but she had a very good delivery and a gorgeous boy.
I just want to say it's not, in addition to the two that we can't do them all at once, some of them build capacity to do others.
Exactly.
So I would encourage everybody to think along those lines.
Right. So we have suggested that we push parking and transportation down to before place management, and we then go to the next group, housing. So.
Hi everyone, I'm Ileana Tasher. I'm gonna talk about what the housing group talked about. Unfortunately, it's very low attendance. I think David Gibbs is not in the room right now, but it's me. Where is
he? No? Yeah. He has a fundraiser, he'll be in and out.
Yeah, so it's basically me and him tonight, so it will be short, actually. And I don't want to talk too much about what we talked about last time, but I will talk about some of the items that we expanded upon. So we identified in the past, in the first conversation when we did the breakout groups at the last LOCUS meeting, we came up with the two following priorities, which were to ensure the greatest level of housing preservation and production for extremely low income, upwards of 170% of AMI, and to provide the good mix of housing, which would include family, market rate, senior, and attainable housing, and to do so through both new housing creation and through preservation and acquisition and rehab of existing housing stock. So to those priorities, we added the promotion of home ownership as well as rental housing opportunities, encouraging property management functions are kept at the local level, and that property management is kept local specifically to Union Square stakeholders. To streamline and ensure accountability of tenant and home buyer marketing and selection policies and procedures for attainable housing options. To gain long-term opportunity or community control of a percentage of land to be redeveloped in Union Square and for family-friendly housing to be developed over time. And to focus additional efforts and resources on acquiring and rehabbing existing Union Square housing stock. That was kind of fast. Does anybody have any questions before I go on? We had a series of action items. We had seven from last time, which I'm also not going to go through again in great detail because this document was distributed, but I am going to expand upon some of the ones that we talked about in the group. We don't have numbers for you tonight. We were hoping to get a rough estimate of some numbers. I imagine that we're going to base that off of the numbers that came out of the Sustainable Neighborhood Initiative planning document in terms of what's needed. But we did talk a little bit more about financing options. So we want to utilize the existing Housing Trust Fund, but build its staff capacity and financial resources to accomplish the goals that I just outlined. To do so, we imagined using CBA proceeds, prorated portion of linkage and CPA proceeds, and a possible Union Square diff. We also expanded on our second action item last time, which was to establish a land trust. We'd like to do so to ensure long-term community control of certain parcels. We hope to obtain those through negotiations with developers and city or state landowners. and then to capitalize the land trust with the housing trust fund and other leverage resources. We also talked about, again, about a transfer tax. We talked about providing density bonuses for developers that may be able to build higher and to provide certain community benefits. We talked about obtaining the results from US2 amenities that we need for family housing. I have some of them and can go through them, but we didn't discuss them in great detail because we didn't want to start talking about amenities until we started talking about some of the more basic financing options for development. And then the other thing that we added is to develop housing resources and assistance from local universities and colleges. A lot of our conversation also focused again on establishing this place management entity. We think that that's actually really important for the housing goals in particular, and in particular hiring someone who can oversee everything that we've outlined, because it's I mean, a lot of the financing is going to come through operations and personnel. So that pretty much is it. The next time we meet, we do hope to put some numbers to some of the things I just talked about, to give you guys more of an idea of what we're thinking. But I'll take questions, answer them to the best of my ability.
Hi. Did you end up talking about, like, middle income? Because, I mean, the city's going to require a certain percentage of low-income housing. Mm-hmm. And then the developers are going to go for high-income housing. But the big problem I see here is medium-income housing.
Mm-hmm.
And did you discuss how you're going to solve that issue?
Yeah, we talked a lot about middle-income housing, and which is why we tried to use attainable as opposed to affordable housing in some of these documents. And I'll email this to Chris so that he can distribute it to the group. But we do realize that there is definitely a necessity for somewhere between 70% and 120% AMI. It is something that we're talking about. We want to make sure that the mix reflects what some of the prior studies show is necessary for the next.
So, we're on to civic space and the library writ large.
Maybe.
Maybe not.
Good evening. So, the civic working group met earlier today. So, this is still hot, it's fresh. And, can you see? Okay. So we came up with a prioritized list of program elements. And we also provided some information, this is not entirely fleshed out, about some of the features that may be included with each of these programmatic elements. And also what we think is rather innovative feature, also including information on where we think potentially some of these programmatic elements can be located, including a connection, possible connection to the Green Line station. So having said that, this first slide includes a list of some of the top priority program elements. And we came up with a scale of 1, 2, and 3 for to determine the priorities. And on the bottom, which you probably can't read, so I'll read it to you. The first, number one, were those programmatic elements that we thought were critical that either don't currently exist or are not accessible to all. So that was priority number one. Priority number two are items, programmatic elements that we thought were valuable insofar as they may already exist, but we need more of them. And number three, were those programmatic elements that we thought were dispensable because either they exist in some capacity and more of them is not needed. And I'll give you the sneak preview is none of the programmatic elements were rated a 3. So in no particular, well, start on the top, I suppose. The first programmatic element, as you can see, is this the idea of this meeting space, which includes space for larger and smaller groups. It also includes
performance space, and this idea of the community living room, a place where people can gather either individually or as a group. There'll be publicly available Wi-Fi, place to just come and hang out. And all kinds of things can happen in that space, but it's not programmed in any way. It's just an informal space. That's the living room. You come and you gather with other people. The next programmatic element was the idea of a welcome center, along with a community leadership program, where new residents in particular can get information about available housing, schools, English classes, healthcare, etc., as well as to provide some type of opportunity for them to develop leadership skills. And the innovative feature of this is that we're looking at this in the capacity of some connection with the Green Line station, and possibly at the Green Line station at the lower level, where folks can get that information while they're entering the subway station or exiting from the station, sort of meet the people where they are approach. The next programmatic element is we identified a need for affordable daycare for residents. And again, we thought that the location for that daycare might make sense to also have that be in the Green Line station. Again, meeting people going to work, whether it's in Somerville or elsewhere, drop your kid off at the daycare, hop on the train. Get off the train, pick your kid up, and you're on your way. The next programmatic element was some type of identifying the need for some type of shared retail space, okay, with shared amenities. And again, we thought proximity-wise, why not locate that in the Green Line station as well? Again, bring the retail to where the people are, in this case. Make it convenient.
Another slide.
We continue with priority one, programmatic elements, the next of which is the community kitchen and cafe that also serves as an incubator for food startups. And again, we thought that the location of this might make sense to have that be in the Green Line station. Pick up something to eat when you're getting on the train or off the train, or other possibilities or points of connection. Another programmatic activity that we felt there's a great need for is some type of dedicated teen space, and with programs that are targeting that age group. That one will be above ground, although the kids might prefer it to be below ground. That was our idea. And the next one is the location of the SCAT TV offices and studio, the production environment. It also serves as a community resource, all kinds of programming, instructional classes, workshops, and whatnot. And next slide. And finally, we get to the those items that unfortunately did not qualify as a priority one. And I'm proud to say that as the director of libraries and also the work group, the convener, the facilitator of this work group, I was okay with the fact that the library was rated priority. So let it be said, in terms of people think there's a conflict of interest, the library was a priority too. Just put that out there. Okay, the other elements that were identified as a priority too, and I know Stephanie will be upset when she hears this, it's my fault for forgetting to include her in the conference call this afternoon, is the rec center idea. We think it's important, but not a priority one. Okay. We also talked about the library. The next item was that ended up as a priority too. It was the idea of a small business incubator with a job career training center. Again, we thought that was important, but not critical, not a priority one. And lastly, we identified a need for a health clinic. We think that's a good idea, but again, in competition with some of the other ones that we've mentioned, it was rated a priority two. And finally, last slide. In case you're wondering, second to last slide. We also identified potential partners with whom we could develop some of these ideas, these programmatic elements, and also for funding resources, because we realize that this is going to carry a pretty hefty price tag. So we're trying to think creatively about how we can fund some of these things, make them happen. So in no particular order, this is a
list of the potential partners that we identified, and no doubt there's room for more. In fact, it'd be nice if we could double or triple the number of partners that we've identified, because I think there's potentially that many out there. And then lastly, in case you're wondering, these are the members, fellow members of the working group, two of whom are in the room tonight. So, in fact, Joe and Dave, do you want to...
Irma's here too.
Pardon me?
Irma's here too.
Irma, forgive me, I'm so sorry. Do you guys want to add anything to what I've already mentioned?
Great job.
It was a team effort. Any questions from the group? Yes.
I noticed that you have a daycare center. You have a daycare center and the team community center. You also list the senior program as one of the potential allies. And have you thought about making it more intergenerational?
That's a great idea. We hadn't really discussed that, but I think we did have some conversations about intergenerational stuff, but not really at the level that you're describing. So is anyone taking notes?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. I think that's a great idea. Another question?
I'm just wondering about the daycare center being underground.
Yeah. Good point. We had, you know, that's a great point. We hadn't really discussed it in detail. David, did you want to mention something?
I don't think we literally meant underground. More attached to the Green Line station in some sense, in close proximity to the Green Line station.
I would edit your slide that way, that, you know, ground level, because there are two ground levels potentially near the Green Line.
Yeah.
And you prioritized a lot of stuff at the T station, but I think that, you know, looking at some of these things, they could be quite close, but not
right. Literally there, exactly.
Real estate there. So, Front Street, Back Street, or
yep.
Street level or not street level.
Great. Thank you for mentioning, for bringing that up. Yeah, we'll definitely, as I said, this is this plan is fresh. It's still warm, so there's a lot of more fleshing out and thinking to do about this, about the idea of the adjacency and the proximity and not literally underground. So thank you for bringing that up. Joe?
The one other thing that we were talking about, some of the fits, is that partners list. It really would be useful for us to be talking with those partners as we proceed in the next couple of phases. Because if they want to be joined, if they want to join, it gets bigger. And if they don't want to join, there's still a lot of others.
Right, for those of you who didn't were able to hear that, Jill mentioned the fact that it would be a good idea as a next step, and the group also discussed this, to going back to this list of potential partners, is to initiate conversation with them as a next step to help us further refine and develop the plan. Is there a question on that?
You've already said it earlier. What criteria were used to determine which groups, which items, what category one or category two? What criteria?
Okay, sure. one more slide, please. Thank you. There we go. So those criteria were, again, for criteria one, priority one rather, the criteria were that either that programmatic element does not currently exist anywhere in the city, or it was not accessible to all residents of the city. Dave, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, so for example, looking at performance space, you know, the Davis Square Theater certainly exists. If one wanted to rent out a theater space, it's there, but it's not, you have to pay for it, it's a private venue, it's not a community venue. So it's sort of, I mean, this is a very inexact rating idea, but that's the kind of thinking we applied to it. Is there something like this in the city already? How accessible is it to folks? How you know, at a number of levels.
And similarly, so number two then, the criteria for that were that it may already exist, but we thought that we needed more of it in the city. Okay, Joe, did you want to expand on that?
Yeah, it may make sense now that this is going to go to the larger group to have more numbers. And ask people to rank in their perception how important this is, just in terms of, you know, their own sense of importance, for us to have a better handle on that.
That's a great idea. Joe's suggesting input from more people, perhaps enlarging, expanding the number of priority items, not items, but the scale, so to speak, it'd be great to have more input. Esther?
Two things. One, I just think it's worthwhile to look at the art farm that the Arts Council's looking at, because they're actually talking about some of these.
Yeah, right.
So just to keep that in mind. And then in terms of the health facility, because we lost that one in Union Square, and my understanding was even the one that existed, that didn't meet the need, so I just think it's worth looking at that and seeing, is that a one or a two?
Sure, we may need to rethink the idea of the priority of the health clinic, so thank you for that. And
I think there's a distinction also between what should be public amenity or publicly developed amenity and what might be very desirable businesses or something that could come in. So the retail space may be a part of another package of uses. The health clinic, you're looking for a vendor to come in and do that. And that would be a great thing to have. Even affordable daycare might be. I mean, the daycare that I think just recently closed, it was at in Davis right next to the two, I'm sure functioned the way you're talking about. So I think that's another combing through of what is really not going to make anybody any money under any circumstances and therefore is really a public benefit only, you know, operation. And I think that the only other thing I think that in your first two components, which I think are both fantastic, I would say that the community living room to me makes more sense as part of the welcome center. You know, a big room where people can sit around, and that the meeting performance space is a very specific kind of room that should be attached to the welcome center. I mean, I can see an architectural program here very easily of these parts coming together, but to me, that hangout space attached to ESL, attached to the leadership programs, made more sense. And I think I would be careful about the below ground designation. I just don't think it's what you mean.
Right.
And I think that it's more about how public does the face of that space need to be versus can it be something that's a little, you know, the daycare center, people are going to find. They'll know it's there. They know how to get there. They've signed up for it. It's not walk-in wandering. But certain species of this, the community living room space, you want people to just stumble across and come into. So it's that kind of categorization.
I had a similar suggestion to Anne's around the idea of perhaps combining some ideas together. So if you think about, I know one of your priority two areas was some sort of gym, basketball court, et cetera. I think part of that is for indoor space, especially in the winter, which I think relates to the teen room and the idea of an intergenerational space.
Right.
But part of that is also wellness. And so when you think about the health center, perhaps there's some sort of actual wellness facility that is a combination of some of those things. It might not be a full basketball court, but it could be one of those half basketball courts or like a little indoor racket.
Yoga classes.
Yeah. Yeah, something like that. Or even the performance meeting space could be architecturally designed to serve that purpose. So thinking about the multi-use and how those different programs come together could be helpful.
The public meeting room is, well, because I hate this room, has been a driving thing for me, but when I give community design charrette stuff and studio stuff, I'm always saying every community needs another great room. And one of the ways to expand understanding that use is that if you have a not only publicly accessible, but a beautiful room that you can rent out to people for wedding receptions and parties and, you know, things like that. I think that, you know, it doesn't have to be a total loss leader, but it only works that way if you make it a really beautiful room, which possibly a garden, you know, connection or something like that.
On your list there, an organization like the YMCA can actually fulfill a lot of the different items. They do it now, daycare center, you know, a lot of the different things. And they are actively looking to either remodel or to relocate. So, which we're going to need a lot of help from the community on to raise money for that. But I think just looking at it, you know, again, you have an organization like that that's community based that could handle a lot of the issues that you brought up today. And the other thing too is to kind of go on what Ann had said, just knowing the T, trying to incorporate anything into that station is going to be really, really difficult. They're looking to downsize stations, not increase the sizes. And I know they have their template for stations, and I know just it's a really hard thing to try to do. So I agree. I think that as the proximity in certain things like daycare and things like that, people are going to find it, you know, and the square's not that big. So, but try to incorporate certain things into the T station is going to be really problematic, I think, especially with what's going on right now.
I just wanted to put in my 2 cents that I think the daycare is a really, really needed thing in this area. I had the experience last spring of trying to hire someone who was a Somerville resident and could not find daycare in Somerville, so he could not stay in Somerville, work for me in Somerville, but rather was using a daycare that was close to his job up in Brooklyn.
Yep.
And we went through this multi-month process of him trying to find a daycare slot for a very young child. So it really, really is needed this area. It was very frustrating. And then I just wanted to pile on the idea of multi-use space. In the incubator business, we often see people build things and assume that people will come, and they don't come. And so I think the more uses you can have for any one space, the more likely you are to create something that's vibrant and that people, where people actually want to be.
Right. Any questions? Comments?
One quick other one. Another partner agency we talked about when we did put down with Main Street.
Main Street.
Main Street.
Yeah, I just wanted to encourage the idea of that intergenerational space, you know, like the teen and the seniors maybe being on the same floor and the people in between as well. And also in the programming, doing things that are that cross over, you know, so it's not just, okay, senior programming for this, you know, maybe sponsored by the seniors, but it's inclusionary for everybody. Cross over program.
Thank you. Thank you. I can tell this is the heart and soul of you. And again, we do need the prioritizations. So, Len, if anything that you can get to Kira about,
you know, maybe it could be one A, B, C, D, just all priority ones. Some sort of, and again, the idea. Pardon me?
He did the best job.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. And he had the best format that Kira and I were just talking about, that we should use his format. So, Patrick, with Smart City.
Thank you. I might just ask the next one. I was also going to mention that Eric, couldn't be here tonight, and I set up Google folders for each group. So I'm not being a shill for Google, but the nice thing is if you put all these documents there, everyone, including the public, can access them. People can collaborate and know they have the latest version. So I'd encourage you to think about doing that. If you're comfortable, if you want to learn more about using it, Google Docs would happy to help. So, Father Karn pointed out I had the wrong year, but what I did was I added some slides to, some of you may have seen slides we presented in July on Smart City, so I've just added some so that we can retain the material. I'm not gonna go through all the old ones though. So, and I'm gonna go very quickly, so people can always go back and look at this in more detail. But just to go over the definition again of what we're talking about investments in human and social capital, traditional infrastructure, and the disruptive technologies that fuel sustainable economic growth and high quality of life with wise management of natural resources through participatory governance. And the goals at a broad level are economic growth, quality of life, a good city to live in, ecological footprint and sustainability, challenges being social cohesion, inclusiveness, secure digital environment, privacy, that includes data security, and resilience. And I won't go over all the components, but that's just a list of some of the smart city technologies that can be used. And I should also just say, I'll get to it, but we met last Tuesday, and the working group was Joe, and Tate, and Stevens, Ryan, and Phil, who couldn't be here tonight, who's unwell. These are just, again, I'm going to go really quickly, but some of this is made possible by a lot of things coming together right now. Technology is becoming cheaper and more affordable to achieve these goals that we've been talking about. And it really has as much to do with human participation and behavior and interest, as well as data and the technology itself. So you need to make all the pieces of the puzzle work. And if you do, you can get this kind of ecosystem that makes for more sustainability, better government. Again, overarching over a lot of the strategies we have in Summer Vision and the plan and in our LOCUS strategy groups to support these different things and create more efficiency and participation. I'm not going to go over all the objectives, but these are what were coming out of the meeting. And I think at this point we felt it was better to be fairly comprehensive, can boil it down, but this gives a good idea.
Is there a possibility of getting prioritization of these?
The prioritization was done around actions, not objectives. Okay. There was no request for objectives.
Perfect.
Right?
Yep, yep, yep.
They all exist simultaneously in this universe. Yeah. Here are the actions, which you can see are grouped in three different groups. So green is the highest priority in the first phase. Blue is the next priority, the next phase, and then gray is the last phase. So I guess I'll go over these a little bit, at least maybe with the highest priority ones, and then we can get back to it if we have time. So we talked about, and I'll also cover roles and responsibilities, so some of that connects here. So we think there does need to be a city point of contact for smart city infrastructure and planning. Some of it will really have to retain some authority within city government. Establish a working group beyond the working group we have now that has representation with the different public, private sector, and community groups that need to be represented. We need to establish some policies around digging once and getting fiber and conduit in the ground, as well as planning elsewhere. Again, that will require the city's involvement, as well as a backbone connection to the internet. And again, I can talk about that in more detail, but the T is one of our best bets at the moment to get a connection, a strong connection. As many of you know, I spent a lot of time talking about the fifth point. It seems like the easiest, but it's probably the hardest and the most important, which is developing and publishing open data, privacy and security requirements and policies. So where we see smart cities working for all, not a bunch of proprietary applications, are where you have this kind of clear understanding terms of engagement for the public, the city, and private sector participants. So roles and responsibilities. These roles came out of a terrific report that came out since my July presentation. It's on our Google folder, I can send it to anyone, by Deloitte. Some of those earlier graphics were as well. They break it down nicely into six different roles. And what I tried to do is say, are any of these roles, can we take any of these roles out of the city's responsibility? I mean, I think one thing we're all trying to do with these groups is say, the city has limited capacity. Whatever place management organization we establish, we want to not just tell the city and others what to do, but do the work, actually have some responsibility. This came out about half and half. It will depend on the PMO, and it will still require some expertise, so it may require a person or someone or more. But essentially, and this is, of course, our first cut, the strategist and advocate, we think, is a role that the PMO could potentially play. The solution enabler, the PMO could probably play that role. The steward is probably going to have to be the city. We are talking about some sensitive data and some public infrastructure. The director and regulator, again, the regulatory role, I would say, needs to be the city. Connector and protector, again, probably needs to be the city. Innovator and investor, I think, could probably be PMO. So, again, we won't get into too much of the detail given our time. Oh, actually, no, I guess that is the last slide. So, I may have gone quickly. If people want to go back on any of that or have questions.
Can you just
go back, if you're going to leave one up, leave up the one that had the three colors yet, thanks.
Are those your priorities?
I can't remember the, this, but I think some of it has to do with, not that this is more important than that, but that this likely comes before that.
Perfect.
More sequence.
So it's how things can build on each other.
Right.
You don't have the backbone connection, you can't do any of this. If you don't, you know, establish some of the basic strategies, then you can't execute them right.
Yeah, so that's right. And so this is really sequential. And actually, so the backbone that should probably be identified, it doesn't mean we're going to have the backbone in place.
So are those first five, the backbone, are they first from a time point of view? Or do you want to
yes, those are sequential and thus prioritized accordingly.
One of the things about this in terms of the, for all of these things, Chris, I think in terms of how we think about this process and the prioritization, a lot of what everybody is asking for has more to do with thinking than with spending money, in a way. You know, it has to do with providing long-term planning and structure for how the development, as monies come in and development happens, that it happens in a way that is beneficial
exactly.
to everybody. And so
exactly.
a lot of it is, that's why it wasn't just, we talked about this, it wasn't just dig once, it was the think first has to be really comprehensive so that you dig once into that. And that, that's what was going to
be. I did make that faceless. Any other?
I find this tremendously exciting. With the coming of the internet of things mm-hmm. and all of that means. And I was just looking to see that maybe just suggest a word, I'm not sure I see up there, have to do with standards.
Yes.
Because everything will be changing so fast.
Yes.
Because it's such an explosive era.
Yeah.
That yeah. we should consider developing like more than a working group that would be at standards.
Yeah, you're right. I don't, it's captured elsewhere in these slides, but it's true. It's not captured there. And I will say, this is a challenge internationally in Europe right now. They're trying to establish standards for interoperability because, again, a lot of these technologies are proprietary. But I would say, you know, at a first principles level, what I think would be ideal for the city to establish not only are open standards, but open access at the hardware, software, and data level. Minus things that need to be protected, rather than the other way around. So, for example, Bill could choose to develop an app that would run, that would use some of the Audi data for your bicycle app. And it would run on phones that create part of a mesh network. So, you know, absolutely, there's a question of open standards at the hardware, software, and data level. So, remind me.
Are you gonna? Is this gonna be on the New Square Futures website? So we
yeah.
can
the this is on the shared drive, the shared folder. So I suppose we'll get them eventually on the website as well. But the nice thing about those shared folders that got published is you can continue to work on them, but people can access them. I should say that when we had our meeting. I put this in slides, but we also have a Google Doc that has this information and more. And that would be what we will give you.
Right. Sorry. Yes. So what I'm hoping is that we can report back out to you using what you've set up on Google Docs.
Yeah, I think that if everyone's comfortable with that, I think that's a big advantage.
Rather than more paper or a separate file.
Right, we don't have to rely on email. Exactly. Everybody can go to the folder site. Those are set up.
Yeah, all of them.
Okay. All right, so I guess I'm starting the next one.
Well, I have one question. You might have covered it already, but it's similar to what Steve commented on. Given how fast things are changing in this, what is the plan for accommodating that rapid change?
Yeah. Well, in a way, it's the topic we just covered, which is, you know, the tension in technology and innovation tends to be between, if you force me to wait for standards, I can't innovate. So it's easier to innovate in proprietary, you know, my app works versus my app talks to Europe. So taking time to create the open data policy for the city and to create those standards at the different levels ensure that whatever comes next, generally, as much as possible, can talk to it.
Including physical infrastructure?
Yeah, that's what I was saying, hardware. So ideally, for example, you want to have that fiber network for the backbone and the pipe, but we would want to have some wireless connectivity, not only for the public and Wi-Fi, like we know. Sensor networks operate at a different wireless frequency, and it'd be nice to add to that, you know, for different projects around measuring pollution or, again, you know, bicycle.
So if you need to replace the fiber every 5 or 10 years, that's part of it.
Yeah, fiber it generally doesn't, but yeah, for each level you need to kind of address how often does it need to be. And the good news is that fiber does not need to be upgraded very often. Those sensors and other things might, but they're easier to access and they're cheaper. But anyway, so yeah, it's a bigger discussion, obviously, a bigger topic. So, okay.
Okay, so now we're going to go to the parking and transportation.
Yep.
Yeah, so Wig, you want me to start that? So,
yes.
Yeah, so unfortunately, Philip is not well and couldn't be here. We're just working from notes at that meeting. And in addition to Wig and I, Bill was at that meeting. Who? Yes, that's right. Yeah, Greg and Paul. And anyone else? No. Okay. So I'll just do my best to read from some of these notes here, and then we can talk a little bit about it. And Bill and Paul and Greg and Wick can chime in with what I've missed. So we talked a lot about potential parking authority. Didn't come to any conclusion about the nature of that organization per se, but talked about it having some capital control and ownership of the facilities with a goal of 80% of district parking to be owned by this entity or agency and 100% managed. And this would include on-street parking and meters, ideally. And that the authority needs to be able to set pricing. Pricing should follow a demand-based scheme to minimize auto trips and maximize revenue to the broader, you know, PMO and different groups and benefits. That it guarantees a percentage of parking to be available at all times to minimize added miles of hunting. So a lot of it is about minimizing the traffic and frustration. We said that the future parking facilities should be short-term, central, and shared, and mid-term to favor automated parking structures. Of course, that's partly the work that's taken on by Audi at the moment, and longer-term to favor automation and self-parking. There's an opportunity of the ownership of the facilities to be, the structures need to be flexible because ideally over time there'll be fewer cars and less need for parking. So Philip, for example, pointed out you need flat floors in order to turn them into commercial or working spaces. Design with that flexibility in mind, and even the potential, very long-term potential for more open space. And for funding, we talked about it as being capital intensive and that the construction can be funded by a DIF or TIF. Operations can be paid for by a base level of developer CBA funds as a short-term bridge to be replaced by parking revenue. And that the parking revenue would repay the financing. After that, it will pass on the revenue to the place management organization. And some initial capital costs could be contributed by developers in lieu of their parking requirements, accelerating the financing period. So let's see. I don't know if we can go through all this, so maybe you can point out anything I missed here, but we had some questions. You know, can we disallow residential parking permits for this development? How to integrate other mobility goals? We did talk about the importance of cycling, even bicycle parking, hubway access, the fact that Uber and other rideshare programs require more pickup and drop-off points to be effective and not create traffic. To make sure that there is a traffic and parking study and plan for all developers and understand the impact. That no one can develop until there is a parking solution in place. Questions of cross-compensation to the master developer. Can there be a single parking authority solution? Let's get into all of these details. We talked about other mobility issues. I'll get into all of this in the interest of time. We talked about how this relates to the GLX goals in Grand Junction. Wade, that might be something you want to address. Critical path as far as public transport goes, and the potential flyover bridge to be dedicated to bicycles and pedestrians as a solution to our bridge woes, our complexity. Potential to deck over the tracks and make use of the air rights. Importance of placing a lot of that structured parking at the periphery, away from the center of the square. Yeah, there's a bit more, but I don't, does that mostly cover the key things?
Yeah, I think you should take any questions.
Yeah.
I'm going to say a few things about the green line, but why don't you finish up this section?
Yeah, okay, so folks have...
Yeah, if you're going to go with the parking authority, how is their incentive structure? Did you talk about their incentive structure? And you know, if we've got some new entity, whether it's public, private, or some mix, you know, does it exist to provide parking, or does it exist to manage transportation into Union Square? Because, I mean, I think we really need to do the latter. We don't need, you know, these guys don't want to build any more parking than they have to in order to get their tenants in and get their you know, retail and household and commercial tenants to come in. And at the very least, a new PA needs to share that incentive.
That's better. Right.
It would be structured so that it's not just its mission, not just the words, but the actual existential, you know, survivability of it depends on their actually reducing transportation demand and so forth, and not just having parking facilities that they have to manage and optimize the revenue from.
I think those are good points. I think some of that, you know, we covered, but perhaps didn't say explicitly, because you know, you could see, in a sense, the mission is to go out of business.
Right.
The hope that there isn't such a need for cars in the future. And that's why the flexibility is important and the centrality and the management. And I think also, to your point, you know, the mission is about managing mobility and traffic, addressing needs, and being able to back off of the qualities.
Yeah, one of the things that every one of them we talked about was also using the parking authority as a potential funder for a transportation management association.
That's true, yeah, I didn't get to that. That's right. That probably it also addresses
it. It was part of, you know, getting to not just parking, but it was an overall issue.
That's right, yeah. So there may still be something, I think, Eric, to your point about, well, what sort of metrics, you know, KPIs do you have around, are you doing it?
It seems like that having a centralized authority would give you actually a better shot at that than having businesses develop their own parking.
Yes, I don't mean to say that, but I do. The incentives have to be structured and managed extremely carefully. Think once and done.
That's why we're putting in charge.
I gather, too, that the current zoning doesn't let you do freestanding. We need the zoning to adjust to have to allow the
structured park
freestanding structured parking, because the idea of a lot of this is to, you know, is to create that centralized, or not in the center, but that unified system,
well,
so that people are not building a lot of podium parking.
Right. To that, and there's a lot of ways for it to be peripheral. There's, you know,
right,
around the outside, but there's up and down as well. So the street, you know, the 30 feet streetscape doesn't have to be impacted by parking. It can be below or even above that.
Yeah. I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure we recognize it as a zoning issue. So that.
Well, I think first it's a physical issue. Right. I was only there for the beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think there's any need to make it freestanding. If you can integrate at least some ground level retail in.
Yes.
That means the line of zoning, as I understand it.
Right. Okay. Any other?
I just want you all to know that Philip is well enough.
Okay.
That's great.
Yeah. He did email a bunch of us saying, I can't be there, I'm in the hospital. Okay, what's wrong?
Forgive me, this is something really new for me, but I don't know if you mentioned the revenue of this, how it will impact the community, or how they will invest the revenue in the community. Yeah.
Well, just at the highest level, I was saying, I think what we talked about was first, you know, recapturing the cost and then redirecting it to the PMO and the community benefits.
What kind of benefit do you think we can have in the long term?
Yeah. Well, I assume, so people jump in, that that's what we're defining right now.
Yeah. Yeah. Parking could be a great cash cow.
Right.
And to which point?
Not up front.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If people still have cars, side of that.
Exactly.
That's right.
And then it's an interim land use.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was curious. You mentioned the TIF, and earlier in the housing presentation, they mentioned another TIF. I've also heard that a TIF would be used for Boynton Yards. And I'm beginning to wonder, is there an upper limit to
how much? I have no idea.
Yeah. I mean, it seems like we're.
But I mean, yeah,
TIFing out. There is. Yeah. Chicago has TIFed out, and it's robbing Peter to pay Paul.
Yeah, I think that's what I'm concerned about.
What we do have in Massachusetts, unfortunately, is we have the IQ, the Infrastructure Incentive Investment Program, that comes where the state is essentially the bonding agent. And. The debt is serviced by the additional incremental increase in income tax revenues and sales tax revenues. And it, to the extent that those increments service the debt, the city's gets away without paying anything.
But that's money that doesn't go into the general fund or education or public services.
No,
it does. It does. 100%
of it does.
After, over and above the debt service.
Because it's not paid by the community in any way. It's covered by the state instead. So Assembly Square
the
was...
State, under the IQ, state based.
Yeah, so Assembly Square was the first use of that in the state. No other community has stepped up in its first 10 years of existence. The reason being that if the jobs don't develop, and the retail sales don't develop, then the community does have to pay it back, but only in that instance.
And otherwise, the revenue for the parking fees, we do whatever we want to with it.
So that
can
be dedicated?
Yeah.
Once it
happens.
Yeah. I have an unrelated question just for clarification. You mentioned something about residential parking. Can you clarify what you meant by that?
Only if you can remember what I said.
You said something about, you said doing away with the residential parking permit or something like that?
I think there was a question whether the residential, some of it could come under, let's see.
You wanted to deny permits to the new.
Again, this is not my notes or my group, so. What was the name?
I think what you said was that considering the possibility of not giving residential parking permits to new projects.
Two people living in new projects?
Presumably. Oh, no, I wasn't there. I just wanted to say.
It's
probably wouldn't work.
You know, I think that's a detail that has to be worked out later.
Let me move on to the green line.
Yeah.
I would like to start that as something to work out later, if we can, because that's concerning to me.
Right.
Well, I'm not sure that's exactly what the point is, but everyone can have a look at these notes and add. Speaking of which, we need a volunteer, depending on how Philip is doing, to help with this. I have my hands full with the smart cities, so if someone would like to work on this, help.
Especially work with Kira on this and whip it into the same format that we're going to be developing over the next few days.
Yeah. And Kira might want to send an email out to everyone because I don't think we've had any introduction email, so. Yeah, because we don't have your information, so.
Yeah, so Philip didn't want to, well, first, we didn't have time to integrate green lines into this. And secondly, Philip didn't want to use a lot of the time in the group on the green line. So I'm going to just give a little update. The general situation is this. So STEP is gearing up to help coordinate green line activity from the community. In everywhere but Union Square, STEP has a lot of allies. So it has the Community Path allies. It has the Medford Green Line Neighborhood Alliance allies. In Union Square, there have not yet developed allies to carry some of the load of Green Line advocacy. So that's not a call to arms for tonight, but just saying that we're trying to work with different advocacy groups in different parts of the community, with Conservation Law Foundation and others regionally, so that we are ready to advocate for the Green Line here. Without it, this development is going to look very different. So I just wanted to give you a flavor for what's going on. There have been about 30 meetings at the State Transportation Building. About half of those have focused on the Green Line. There are about 6 a month, so it's pretty intense. And we'll try to, when we need a lot of people, we'll let people know. But other than that, we'll try to just gear up a few people to start to accompany us and make comments. So far, it's very different from 10 years ago when we had very full participation. We were actually 80% of all transportation comments for 4 million people in eastern Massachusetts, and that level of activity has gone way down. We need to gear back up. So just to give you a flavor, this is from one of the presentations in the last month. So the total cost allowed by the state and the federal government was just under $2 billion. And if I can go to the next slide. Okay, so the left-hand column is that basically $2 billion, $1.992. Their new estimates were between $2.7 and $3 billion, so that's what has the state so upset. And I do think they're unfairly focusing on this project. They have 50 large projects, many of which are over schedule and over budget, and this one's getting most of the attention. Next slide. Keep going. So there are questions about whether they proceed. It would not be that easy for them not to proceed unless they can show equal environmental benefit from some other options. Next slide. So one thing they're working very hard on is cutting the project scope. Some of these cuts are extreme, but they have a list of about 60 different types of cuts at this point. Some of them are logical. Some of the stations were over-designed in the beginning. So it's somewhere in between that's rational. Next slide. So additional funds. This is where they would look for local contribution. That there is a concern about competitive position. It would be very difficult for Somerville to fund transit when Boston and Cambridge have not funded transit. So that would be one issue there. I think at the same time, Somerville has shown with Assembly Square that what we can do, we're willing to do. So next slide. Additional funds. Yeah, so relieve pressure on the Commonwealth. And they would need the partners to step up for that. Next slide. Change procurement method. So they used a very radical method of contracting where they named the contractor before they had a bid, a competitive bid. And that a number of us argued against that, but they convinced the whole state legislature to let them do that with a vote on Beacon Hill. You don't expect the legislature to necessarily be experts at this, so that was an unfortunate mistake. Next slide. So this is on the table. So canceling the whole project or maybe canceling just Union Square. And I think that's it. But maybe there's one more.
Okay, all ideas welcome. There are going to be some public meetings here, but they're probably too late. They're probably after the decisions will have been made. So we will have to gear up, and we will need some kind of expertise developed in Union Square as well as in STEP and the regional entities like Conservation Law Foundation in order to start to head this off now and not wait till they've made a decision and then try to argue it back. So I just wanted to do that update. Obviously, this is big. It's kind of, yeah, sure, Pat.
Just a couple quick things. Of course, this means a lot to Union Square and Somerville, but it also does to Cambridge and Medford. So I assume any effort we're making to get the public engaged.
Yeah, so Medford are, Cambridge is a partner because of Leachmere.
Right.
And even
Union Square.
Inman Square. Yeah, I think Cambridge is particularly focused on North Point, and they probably will make some contributions to assist with that. We have worked in the past pretty closely with East Cambridge residents, and then Medford is all in. The Medford advocates are all in right now, but they are not the Union Square branch.
And then are there some milestone dates coming up that we need to be aware of other than September 9th?
There are, and they're hard to pick out. You basically have to go through about 30 presentations to pick the key dates. I would say as a general rule, there is at least one, so there is at least three financial management and control board meetings per month, and then there are probably three other meetings. There is one joint meeting of MassDOT and the MBTA financial management and control board. That tends to be the day on which key information is discussed.
Do you expect at any of those points there'll be some preliminary announcements by the state?
No. One of the difficulties of people going to make public comments at these meetings is that there is no advance disclosure of the materials for the meeting. So it's you can talk about anything that's on the agenda, but without seeing the materials that they're going to be discussing in advance, it's kind of hard to make the comments. But yeah, I mean, a couple of us are going, we're going to need to broaden that out to 5 to 10 people going to a lot of the meetings. And then at some point, we'll need a lot of people to participate.
They don't publish what's on the agenda?
Just the head topic. They don't publish any of the materials. They're quite good at putting the materials up after the meeting, and they're all organized and they can be found. But before, and this has been commented on at the meetings, before the materials are not available. So it makes it a little bit hard to kind of tactically counterpoint what's going to be discussed. But I didn't want to take a lot of time. I just wanted to do a little bit of update. Yeah, Steve.
The gap between the budget and the forward-looking estimates is $700 million or $800 million.
Right.
Would you hazard any kind of guess as to what they would be looking for, public, private, cost share out of some?
Well, it's pretty hard to guess right now. One of the difficulties is that the outside estimate when the federal full funded grant agreement was applied for was $2.5 billion. If they had gone with that independent estimate, we wouldn't have a problem at all right now. That it was the state that said, no, we don't think it's going to cost that much. We think it's only going to cost $2 billion. So that caused a lot of the crisis here. But another part of the crisis is the full construction economy in Boston and Cambridge right now. So the same trades work on transit projects that work on building projects. Very hard to get competitive labor bids at this point. So ironically, if we had a little bit of a collapse, it would help these prices. It would hurt the general economy. Bill?
When the working group met at the Armory, that was either Frank DePaul or Jim Wright, I don't remember which, said, we can't build the Green Lane without building the Union Square extension.
No, that's
he said.
Well, that's not correct. Yep.
He said it.
He may have said it, but it's not correct.
Well, I hope it is because I went with it in my column.
So they've laid out about $5 or $6 million to try to re-budget this. They're 1.7. They're $750 million into this project. So $5 or $6 million to relook at it is they're not going to get a very deep look at it. I'm done with that. We are going to move to place management. I think we're going to start with Mike.
Yes.
So, by the way, just my impression that, this strategy that you've just gone through, your strategy, is killer. And it will really create a very vital, mixed income, diverse place that's going to be, from a purely economic point of view, really quite something. And I would love it, therefore, to be, if somebody brought up about the tax giveaways. I hate tax giveaways. And that great places don't have to give away things to get companies to move in. So this strategy will put you, I think, in that position where they will be knocking on your door. The question is how to get from here to there. So we'll go to Mike and talk about first how it fits into the context, and then we'll go to the place management. And Wink, who is it, Dave?
Me and Wink.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Mike, we're going to have to.
Thanks a lot. Wink, thanks for going through that. Before we forget for this evening, on behalf of the city and all of our members of our team, I want to thank everyone again this evening. And Clement Knight, this is really important work. You're doing a tremendous job. And we want to thank LOCUS as well for their commitment to work with us. So why don't we put the schedule slide up? Because I want to, again, out of full respect to everyone here and everyone who's been working on this, even though they couldn't be here this evening, we want to make sure that we're communicating to you again what we've been saying in a number of meetings and kind of following up with what we just mentioned. So sequentially here in this calendar chart, you see the green line. In fact, we'll probably put big question marks on top of those decision points. But what we're hearing is that by this spring in April, hopefully the staff of the state will be able to put before all of us their recommendation as to how to go forward, or remembering the slide that Wink showed you, the slide that said either mothball or cancel, that's an important decision point for the staff. Again, we don't control that, the state does, but that's the goal, that by mid-April or early April, the state staff will be, the MassDOT staff will be going public with what they believe to be the best path to go forward regarding the Green Line and its decision. Then, following that same line, we see that the Financial Management Control Board is going to be making its decision as to how to implement and pay for that recommendation, whatever that recommendation is. So it's a critical juncture. Dates may change, but we don't think they will. Well, we need to work together. Thank you, Wig, for reminding us that this is not over. We need to work together to make sure the voices are heard throughout this process. But we are trying to work collaboratively with the state to look at what are all the alternatives that should be considered before we make those final decisions on how to move forward. The neighborhood plan, and we talked about it earlier, neighborhood plan has a timeline. We think it is critical that our timeline, that we work hard together to resolve the neighborhood plan so that we can give evidence to those decision makers at the state level that we're ready to embrace a growth and development plan for Union Square, Boynton Yards that will fulfill the estimated opportunities for growth, development, and revenue that we continue to say to the state is part of the compelling reason, not the fundamental reason, which goes back to the big dig and issues that and clean air and the other issues that Wig and others have talked about. But we believe that the proof points that we put on the table include economic development opportunity to the state and to our community. And our neighborhood plan is the vision. And I would also interject that I thought the conversation earlier, Ian, about making sure that we embrace flexibility, that the exactness of each parcel is hard to do, but making sure that we get what we want in the plan is really critical. So our timeline is very much in parallel with that decision process because we want to make sure that we're telling the state we're ready to go forward with the type of growth and opportunity and development that we believe in for this area. The next timeline is the zoning. The zoning is the DNA that comes from the planning. And so until we resolve and complete our neighborhood planning with the community and ultimately the approval process with the planning board, we won't be able to launch with specificity the zoning. That comes in and you see a timeline for that that starts as we embrace the decision on the plan and then we do the zoning work that then takes us out another at least 3 months in a process to make sure that we get the DNA right. The zoning that will be in place to allow for the type of growth in the plan that we've approved. We come to this process. And this LOCUS process has been really, really exciting. And we think what will happen, hopefully now in the near future, will be this work will come to a culmination of the early phase of this work, and it will launch two important initiatives. One will be the PMO, or Place Management Organization conversation, which has already started and has great promise for the future. I think it can be a tremendous component for how we want to make sure that we get the community we want in Somerville. The other is the continuing working on the ideas that are coming out of the subject matter groups that we just talked about. This point in this process is to say, what are the needs, opportunities, and priorities? Once we get to that process of defining those, we need to activate them and think about strategies for implementation, a lot of which are decisions that have to be made about what a PMO is. What is it going to do? What is its function? How should it be organized? How should it be incorporated? The more we know about those things that we want to implement through a PMO or through other partnerships, that will help define that product. The CAC was created, as you know, to advise the Redevelopment Authority. It continues in its role. Many of the members are here and have been participating as strategy leaders on subject matter leaders. They will continue their process. And then what has been often discussed and will continue to be of concern to everyone is, when will we ask the developer to work with us to define the developer's response to all the work we've been doing on community benefits? And until we know the entitlements through zoning, the developer will not have the finality or the specificity as to what they will be allowed to build, encouraged to build, to be able to put the fine points on what are the community benefits that they are or would be prepared to offer to this community as we go forward. So this timeline, it's most important for me to offer this timeline to you. There could be disagreements, there could be changes, there could be opportunities, but we, out of respect for this process, I want to make sure that we put this before all of you to follow up on the conversations we've had at previous meetings. So if we could go to the other slide, just one. Not that one. This is what I know I've said and other persons have said throughout the last 5 to 6 months, which is this LOCUS process has true meaning, and if you follow the steps down, we won't go through all of them, but it has two products. One is the public benefits strategy and action plan, which then becomes the work that we will all do together to figure out how to implement those strategies. And the place management organization, which we believe has a real opportunity for success, and we want to see that work. I know Chris has advised us that that could be a follow-on part of our process. We might be able to get financial support. We need a facilitator. We wanted to take and build on the good work and discussion that's already started. The city's process is to take the LOCUS work and give the CAC, many of the members who are here, give the full advantage of the CAC of the work that you've done. The SRA, at the time of the community benefits discussion, will invite the developer, and this is the first of hopefully many developers, but we'll invite you as to, who is here tonight and has been here faithfully for almost all of the community meetings, just so they are familiar with all of our discussions. The CAC will be advising the SRA, and the SRA will invite US2, the developer, to make its presentation of its best ideas to respond to the community benefits discussion that we've had and the work that we've done for the last several months. Developers can do many things. I would hope that we will all learn to work with the developer as a partner and not as an opponent. I would like to see them collaborate in the discussions that have already started about the subject matters that we've already put on the table tonight and we're going to continue to discuss. That discussion will be open. We will look for the leadership of the CAC to conduct open meetings, invite the developer to make presentations, to answer questions, to hear recommendations and thoughtful suggestions. The work of that CAC goes to the SRA, which will have the formal agreement and understanding under contract with the Redevelopment Authority and the developer to fulfill and implement the community benefits ideas and strategies. That participation is a process. There's not agreement in a number of corners of the community about the entirety of this process, and that's okay. We'll work together. We'll find ways of making sure that we make progress despite our differences. But I didn't want to leave tonight's meeting, which is the next step in the work that we're doing, without making sure that the conversations that we've had about what the city is doing to try to implement a process that gets us to success, I wanted to lay that out again tonight. Sue helped put together the slides so that we can discuss them, debate them, but ultimately we need to be moving forward. And I think the more important slide for the moment is the one that highlights the decision-making that's going on at the state. We need to continue to demonstrate to the state that we demand a response that's adequate and appropriate for our community on the Green Line. And we need to demonstrate that we will be supporting development in the community for the vision that we have for this area. So I needed to take those 2 to 3 minutes to make sure that all of you had that this will be available, make sure we'll put it online, and then we can have further discussion and debate, and maybe disagreement on this, but that's okay, as long as we're doing the work that's underneath all of this. So I really don't want to stop the other presentation, but I'll stay for other questions afterwards if we have time.
Great. Great overview. So David and Wig, that LOCUS has suggested that there's some experts that we'd be willing to bring in at whatever you want to do, and that we would work, we would advocate to BAR about some sort of an implementation grant to help move forward the place management discussion. So, David?
That's great. So the place management group met last Wednesday evening, and perhaps not surprisingly, we had 35 people show up, so the biggest of any of these meetings. The first thing that the group did was pass a resolution, which said that, and somebody please correct me if I garble this, said that that the place management organization that comes out of this process should have a seat at the negotiating table alongside the developers and the city in negotiating community benefits. So that I guess that is the point of disagreement, Mike, and I'm glad you put up that timeline, and we should continue to talk about this. The vote, Paul?
Yeah. I would just like to point out that, David, you did have a vote at the beginning. The audience was a good-sized audience, but as far as the LOCUS strategy leaders, it wasn't.
I was about to get to that.
Strategy leaders.
It was the credit, right?
May I? Thank you.
So that would be good.
The meeting, which, like all of the meetings, was open to the public, was composed roughly, I would say, about 10 strategy leaders and about 25 other people from the community, many of whom certainly identify as unionized, no question. There were some others who identify as neither of those things. The vote was about 23, not about, the vote was 23 in favor of the resolution, none against, 11 abstaining. And I listened to the people who abstained, and I think the majority of them abstained because they were unclear what place management organization was being referred to in the resolution. Is that?
I abstained, and I thought that it wasn't clear what was being proposed.
Yeah. So I think there was a lack.
It wasn't a lack of understanding. Yeah. It simply, I thought it was a poor proposal.
And that's a fair criticism. So I think there was some lack of clarity that led some folks to abstain from the and that's fair. So I don't want to dwell on this too much. I think the point is fairly clear. What we do want to talk about though is what came next, which is about 2 hours, hour three quarters of discussion on different kinds of place management organizations that might emerge from this, and these are by no means the only ones that might emerge, and we need to do a lot more work. So we probably are the least prepared in terms of prioritization and action steps. We have some, but I'm going to turn it over to Wig and ask him to outline this part.
Yeah, Joe, can you wait for a couple of minutes? So I appreciate everybody staying a little late. Philip emailed us, and I got these after five, actually, when I got done with my other meeting, that he would not be able to finish his presentation, and could we step in? So this is a poor substitute for what Philip was working on. We got 40 slides, which exceeds the five-minute time limit, and he wasn't through developing. So I've cut it way down. I cut out a lot of things, including multiple slides on Dudley Square, so just so people know that he had those in here, but we don't have time in the 5 minutes, but we can get back to that. So he started with two views of schedule going forward. I'm not going to dwell on these. He was doing these, I think, for both all of the groups and also for place management, which we realized that place management and governance may take longer. So next. Okay, so this was the agenda that Philip made up for the meeting last week. Jan Cornel had some nice slides on some three examples of place management and places that had kind of multiple partners and multiple objectives, including equity objectives. And I think people appreciated the slides. They weren't part of any debate or anything. It was just Jan coming in based on her experience working with different districts on similar issues to what we're facing. Next. So this is the first one that's really about this, and I think it's kind of self-explanatory that we needed to do something for tonight, but it's just the beginning. Next. And this is a little bit more detailed about the different kind of slices of this, so I think you can read it, but a group of things to be researched, a group of models to look at. Governance is not necessarily the same as place management. It may be, but there are other forms in which the community particularly may want to have input into this that may be broader than a place management organization, that would allow the full community to participate as an equal partner at the table with the city and government on the one hand and with the developers on the other hand. So, and in summary, what I'm trying to say is that it's not clear whether there's just one organization here that can both be the place manager and the community's representative. Next. This you've seen before if you were at the meeting. This came in part from LOCUS, maybe fully, Philip incorporated it. And I would just say that neighborhood association is very broad. There's a lot of neighborhood and community groups around here. They do tend to be grassroots. Some of them are pretty powerful and long-lasting. Some are more temporary. Next. This is, again, just Philip. He had one of these without the parking authority and one with it, but I thought I better put that in there because it's a particular project of interest to his. Can you go back to that? So I think that Philip did not think the Business Improvement District had a lot of legs in the discussion and maybe did not deserve as much discussion going forward. But all of the others he thought were ripe for discussion. CDC, Neighborhood Association. He was a little unsure about Neighborhood. Community Benefits District, which there's been some discussion at the CAS meeting with Andre LaRue, and that's in development at the state. It's not clear whether that legislation will pass or not, but I think the concept is clear. There's been a lot of discussion of community land trusts here, and there are multiple potential benefits for different purposes, and then the parking authority. Next. So Philip did have some slides on four of these. Just had one on CDC. I'm not actually going to go into these details because it's a little bit late. We can get this out to everybody, or we could get the 40 slides out to everybody. Next. Community benefit districts, similar. I think it's kind of modeled after the LOCUS matrix, but just drilling down on the individual types and maybe pluses and minuses and points to consider. Next. Community land trust, and he did note that this was the most discussed in some discussions. And then I added these notes just to make sure people knew that Philip had incorporated a lot of the Dudley Square slides. I just didn't think we could get them in the 5 minutes here. And there are also a lot of neighborhood association models that we didn't have time to consider. Next, parking authority. I think you've already heard pretty well from Pat and Patrick. And so next. So these are general points of Philip. These weren't actually vetted through the community because we didn't have time to share these until David and I got them today. But he, you know, Philip just wanted to get some points down on protecting vulnerable populations, then enhance attractiveness to investors, preservation of community diversity, and I think the bottom that a lot of us have noticed we haven't really tackled very fully, which is a sustainability issue. I mean, it's high priority in the city. It's not integrated yet into most of our discussions. Next. I think this is the last slide. Philip just made a note that there could be hybrids or combinations, and a couple of us have talked about combinations offline, whether it's combined in one group or whether there's multiple ways that citizens can participate with a strong voice and footing. And then requirements and expectations. I didn't really drill down into this. The last line, I think there are some some concern about how the citizens kind of get their footing and keep it longer term. So that's kind of part of the ongoing discussion, I think, Mike, with the government here. Because I think a number of us think in the long run, you just have to have those three different groups with their own footing, that you can't have everything at the end of the day be a contract between the developer and the city government. I think that's the last one. Yeah. So thanks for your patience. Esther?
Well, I think, you know, Jan, who presented three or four cities and the models they did, you know, it's very much a hybrid and right. looked like something well worth considering as an approach. Because what it did is it brought in a way of getting different parts of the community involved together. So
right.
I'm going back to look at those models.
And I think we can post those online for people to look at. I mean, they came from her experience, I think, without prejudice with regard to what we've been discussing at Union Square. They're just basically because she's been traveling around the world and assisting some of these groups. Yep.
So we thank you and David for this presentation, and I actually think that last slide that you did just really, I think, clarified very well some of the priorities that came out. And I think the last bullet point that you mentioned, that was kind of what I understood as the intention of the resolution that was passed. It may have gotten a little confused, but I think the intention was to have a community group, whether or not it's the place management organization, but to have a community group
right.
that is independent of the city that has its own voice in the future of the
right, right. And my take on the abstentions at the beginning of the meeting is just whether we need to get to the consensus and all get behind it or before we kind of say, okay, this is it. Joe?
I think the part that is important is that it was because there was nobody against the motion, there was not neutral.
Right.
It does deliver a very concrete message to the city that there must be some broader participation in the Somerville Redevelopment Authority, in part because we have a history with the Somerville Redevelopment Authority's disdain for some of our recommendations.
Yeah, that was a dispute.
Yeah.
So just one tiny comment on that. There, redevelopment authorities can take a lot of different models. So Boston is giant, and they do most of the planning for the big redevelopment areas. Cambridge Redevelopment Authority actually is a place management organization that is focused almost entirely on Kendall Square. It was formed more than 30 years ago. It does not have the same attributes as some of the current place management organizations. It's gone through a reorganization, but it is a place management organization. Ours is very different. Our redevelopment authority has served most importantly, to execute legal agreements that can't be executed by others. I mean, and this is just my take. I'm not trying to be authoritative. Dan?
Yeah, I just wanted to get back to the, I'm sorry, but I want to go back to the model that Mike was presenting. And that's the San Francisco model. That's a model that has not been successful in San Francisco for the community. It's been very successful for the tech companies because it's essentially a write-off for them. We started looking at that as Union United. We started looking at it about January of 2014, the San Francisco model, because they had a CAC, and their CAC, when there were six different tech companies, six of them, what they do is the CAC makes a proposal, priorities, and they submit that to the tech companies, okay, the same thing as here. And then the employer, the developer, writes the CBA, okay? And then all it has to do is meet the standards that are set. Now, the CAC in San Francisco refused five of the tech companies' proposals, but the city authorized all of them. That was what drew our attention, because the same thing happened here. With the CAC making recommendations and having them refused. We're set up to do exactly the same thing that San Francisco did. We're going to be giving it over to US2 for them to write the CBA. The SRA is then going to determine whether or not it meets certain standards, which in the San Francisco case, they didn't. They ignored, like, you know, some of the top priorities. One was displacement. That was the top priority. It was never mentioned in any of the six proposals. So what we're doing is setting ourselves up, basically. If we allow this process to go forward, we have no control. The developer's going to write the CBA, and the SRA is going to decide whether or not to approve it. And there's no accountability.
So just a personal comment. So Union Square is a test case. We're kind of the canary in the mine here. And I do think it would be better for each of these transformative districts if we could come up with a model of the three bases of opinion, concern, and participation. One being the city government itself, one being the development community or the private sector, the large parts of it, and one being the community and all the residents. I just think, for me, it's that simple.
Basically, what we're saying is that the bilateral, the traditional model is bilateral. And what we're looking at is that we want to create a trilateral process. We want three parties at the table instead of just two.
And there's a lot of precedent for that. The federal transportation conformity
regulations that apply to all roads and transit require those three pieces.
Exactly.
So anyway, I don't want to belabor it. I think it's a discussion in process. You know, and turn it back.
So obviously you've got a lot more work to do on the place management, a lot more education. But I actually, in presentations about place management, I use a three-legged stool.
Yeah.
And private, public, and the third leg, which I say is the most important, is the place management. And those three-legged stools is what make great places work. But right now you don't have the place management organization yet in place. But everything I've heard from Mike and from your mayor is bring it on. So that's what this process is all about.
You've heard bring it on, and we will then decide.
Right.
Yeah.
You did not hear bring it on and join us in the decision.
And there's going to be a really interesting power struggle. I've never, when there's a new level of governance,
right.
I've never seen it where there was no power struggle. So it's going to happen. So what I'm going to suggest that we do next, see if this works for you all, you did a lot more tonight than, quite honestly, we thought you were going to do. So we're going to take what you have, but we have to make sure we get the stuff from you that you were reading from and get connected to, and we've been taking notes, and get access to the Google Docs. And Kira, do you want to stand up? Because
sure.
Kira did not go to a well-known Boston planning school, but she did go to a well-known Philadelphia planning school. And she's with us full-time at LOCUS, and she's, in essence, going to be substituting for Victoria as she's trying to transition to a new life. But she'll be back probably by June 1st, we hope. So Kira will get this back to you, I'm going to suggest, on the Google Docs, so that the strategy leaders can then modify it at will. And then by the 22nd, we'll have the next iteration of your strategy. And by the way, it's really important. There was a comment made earlier, and Luke, you reported it, or you said it again, about the environmental sustainability. That is really important to, I'm sure, almost everybody in this room, including me. It is very important to BAR. That's their number one priority. So you're going to have to hammer, as we introduce you to the folks at BAR, if you don't know them already, that it's got to be pitched as, and that's how we, all of our work basically says building walkable urban places is the number one way we're going to address climate change. Number one way. And BAR understands that. So we have to pitch this to BAR with that as the headline.
Yeah, so I would just say that we may have to form another group that does sustainability and intersects with each of the subgroups so that they can have conversation about that. And we maybe want to work with some of the city departments on that. I think the other thing that we haven't covered yet is the financing. I mean, there was a little bit of discussion of financing, but the I-cubed is a perfect example where, in the one case, it's completely outside financing, it doesn't come out of us with I-cubed. In the case of a DIF or TIF, it's completely local financing, and it does come out of us and takes away from the resources that we can keep for other purposes. So,
wait, what happened to the transfer fee?
No, absolutely. I mean, that's terrific. But we need to look at the financing issues with each of these working groups.
Okay. And then it can be all modeled out, and it can then roll up, and we can take a look. Yeah. And it's at that point that you begin to make the trade-off decisions. This is where the priorities come in. So what has to come first? And because we never have unlimited funds. Nobody ever does.
Right, but if we just use ours, it hurts everybody here. It doesn't matter whether you're the developers, the city, or the community. It just shrinks the pie.
That's right. But you are all in it together. It's the city, it's the developers, and it's the community, all in it together. And if you do it right, you create that vital community, it becomes an upward spiral. And the surplus from the upward spiral pays for all the great community benefits that are in this strategy. So we're going to get something out by the end of the week on the Google Docs. Maybe it might be Monday. And then we'd love you to look at that, edit it, so that by the 22nd we have the next iteration. And I think it's proper that it's on Google Docs, because strategies always change over time. And that's what Google Docs does so very well. So you don't have an out-of-date piece of paper. So any other comments on where we are in the strategy process?
Just curious, what's the rationale behind the dates that you guys picked? There's a really ambitious timeline for this whole process, and I've heard a lot of people ask questions about why it has to be done so quickly. So I'm just curious, like, today's meeting, the 22nd, April 11th, like...
It is to try to keep pace.
I'd say that it's, you know, we're trying to establish a way to move forward and at the same time that the Green Line decisions are
being made. I think the Green Line is really what's driving this more than anything else right now. Without the Green Line, a lot of this discussion is going to be for naught.
But if the Green Line really were the issue, we would wait until April. We're not. We're moving more rapidly.
I think that's
the only issue.
I think that's true. I think we need to show the state progress. We're taking it seriously.
We've been meeting for three years already. There's plenty of stuff to show, and we have made plenty of progress. We've documented it. The truth is, this is fine for that purpose, but for a purpose of genuine participatory planning, it takes more. It really does take some sense of what really are we planning. Okay. That has been the real gap, and we still don't know. We have made tremendous progress tonight, but we still don't know what we're planning. Are we planning housing, business, what are we planning, and in what kind of fashion, and with what kind of money? The truth is, the money's not going to come from U.S. too. It's going to come from some other kind of financing, which is whether it's the famous tax that everybody else pays,
transfer tax,
but the residents don't pay, or whether it's some other formula. The money is important, but the deadline really is not dictated by the Green Line. We're ignoring pretty much the Green Line. We're doing some documentation, and we've done enough, frankly, for that purpose. We are planning in lieu of getting the Green Line, and the Green Line will make it easier to do it, that's all.
So I think we have a lot of conversations left and a lot of evolution. I, as someone who was an audience member for the whole beginning of this and was supposed to be an audience member for this whole meeting, I want to really compliment all the presenters.
Close it out.
I had a comment before Wake tried to close it. Sorry, Wake. That's what I get for sitting behind you. I think just regarding the Green Line, at the last Green Line meeting at the Armory on the very snowy day a few weeks ago, it seems to me, while they may be saying, what economic opportunities are available if we extend the Green Line, I think the reality is they're trying to get the project to happen. It's like an all or nothing thing, and yes, the Union Square branch may be debatable, but they're trying to get the budget down so that they can build it. Not necessarily, oh, if Union Square has this great economic plan for economic impact in Somerville or Union Square, then we will build the Union Square station. It's, do we have the money to build the Green Line or not? So
I don't think that's true. I think that the spur is very, very vulnerable right now.
So that
it's
might
be the easiest thing for them to cut off. And the, but the reason to do the Green Line from the state's point of view is to be an economic engine, and Union Square is the place for that, and we need to make that really clear.
And to generate additional state taxes in the years to come.
So that wasn't clear at that Green Line meeting, so I think that's something to clarify with them moving forward, because that's not the impression that I got as an audience member. And I think the second thing I just wanted to say regarding this discussion of, like you mentioned, the three-legged stool being really important, I think when I moved to Union Square a few years ago and I started attending all these meetings, it was with the hope that this could be a really collaborative process. And I think in order for that to be true, the community needs to be seen as an equal decision maker, not just an advisory panel. I think the CAC has done a great job of that. The LOCUS process and striving leaders have brought together a lot of great ideas. But unless we are seen as an equal, as a three-legged stool, and able to make decisions for our community and for our neighborhood, then it's not going to be a collaborative process. And while I'm engaging with best intentions and with good faith that will happen, I haven't seen from the city that we are being seen as capable decision makers for our community. And I think that may be the point of disagreement, but I think if it's seen as a point of disagreement versus a point of conversation, then we're not going to have that seat and be seen as an equal.
Can I add to that? I think that there is the whole negotiating of an agreement, but the agreement is really just a beginning place, and there needs to be a structure for ongoing discussion with US2 and every other developer who comes in. And so that's part of it, is that we continue, some form of some group continues to be the agency that people come and talk through what they're trying to do and figure out how to move things forward. So it's you're right, and we have to be thinking past any point of the SRA or anybody else signing off on anything.
Okay.
But eventually, you'll be proving yourself as, that you have. Right now, we just saw slides of what place management organization you might select.
I was in that meeting the other day,
right.
So yeah.
And so at some point, you all will figure out what form it's going to take. Right now, it's in the, you're exploring different options. And it's, I've seen it too many times. Place management organizations establish their credibility, and they're the go-to source. If you're focusing on downtown Chattanooga, you're going to go to, River Valley Partners. And they're the ones that start all these great new ideas and make sure this, all this great stuff happens. So you're going to get there.
I have a question about that. In a city like that, there are certainly a number of people whose job that is full-time to be that organization. So what is the relationship between employees who do the day-to-day work in a context like that and the community organization life? Is it that the community organizations form the board of directors?
Yes.
What about citizens?
Well, that's what I mean. That
that's what
the citizens
are not the same.
Right.
Yeah.
Following up on what Kristen said, I think the feeling, the sense, the reality of whether or not redevelopment is happening to meet the community's most fundamental needs and to accomplish its fondest hopes has expressed itself in two ways. One is the issue of negotiating a community benefits agreement. The other is will the neighborhood plan reflect the community's needs and hopes? And what we heard on February 4th is that in fact it keeps moving in the opposite direction. in many in an essential way from what the community wants. So, Michael, I want you to sincerely hear this, that when I hear you say, we've got to complete the plan so we can demonstrate that we're getting the green line, it sounds manipulative, or I shouldn't say that. It's open to the interpretation of being manipulative, because if that's true, then why don't your planners, respond to what the CAC community members and the Board of Aldermen themselves have said that they what they prefer. And I don't mean that as a challenge, but because we are running out of time, because we are being exhorted to come together, then I want to suggest that the movement goes in both directions.
Well, so it's fair, it's understandable, it's an opinion that we've heard. We also have our team working on the plan. There'll be more meetings and discussions to present the plan. We believe that when it's presented and when we have more discussion, hopefully there'll be more acceptance, but there could also be a discussion that maybe there needs to be amended. We believe that we're working on something that is an important product, and it's not just the timing, but we do think we can accomplish the plan as a goal within that time frame if we all work together. So let's see what we can do.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
We just keep going out a little bit farther.